interesting spaces for me, again, thinking about where, and some of the thinking that I've developed over the years, to think about what are these tensions that I have brought this kind of thinking in terms of curatorial practices. And Nontobeko Ntombela often, in his book, asks the question of methodology, how we're thinking about how information is gathered, interpreted and disseminated, how does it speak back to intentions and speak to ordinary and expectable? What becomes hyper-visualized in spaces that we engage with these kinds of conversations? And Kutsia accented this, language of seeing and asking questions has been interesting in thinking about notions of unlearning. This is just been debates that I've used as tools in my curatorial practice and also within the classroom context. Now, the Fragile Archive exhibition was at the Johannesburg Art Gallery in 2012. This showed a work of a number of women artists that was centered around the restage of the Ethical Values exhibition that took place in 1961. And as I've said before, I was interested in this idea of knowing myself. In 2006, I was at a bookshop and I came across Marion Arnold's book called Women Artists in South Africa. And one of the questions that she asked in this book actually stayed with me, because I suddenly wanted to find out why I'm interested in art and what actually defines me and how do I think about applying this critique today in the way that I think about curating. At the time I was working at the DUT Art Gallery, and I was interested in doing my master's. I did register for a master's in 2008, and then a year later I deregistered. And I was really interested in this idea of the first, and as I did my research, it became apparent again in the accuracy with regards to that kind of title. I've brought out here some of the moments in which her position starts to be recorded. First exhibition was in 1961, but these are writings that follow in 1962 exhibitions that she had after that. And it was interesting to me that some of these claims, of course, it was her self-proclaiming to be the first, and acknowledging or taking ownership of the space that she thought that her voice and the voice of a person like her. And one of in the Cape Times, she's quoted saying, "I think I can claim to be the first African woman in the country to hold an exhibition. As far as I know, I am the only African woman who has taken up painting seriously. It has become my first love, and there's nothing else I want to do." And for me, that was quite a powerful moment, because again, that is a moment where in 1962, in my mind, I thought, okay, who would be that bold to kind of assert that kind of position? And then the archive becomes really, the question around the archive really became quite important to me, because later on I discovered that she wasn't the first, but how it was easily taken up that she becomes the first and becomes really etched as the first Black woman artist. But it's interesting to see later on some of the questions or hesitation with some of the writers. Esma Berman, writing for a review of in her Dictionary of Artists and Art in 1970, she starts to have doubts about this position. She says she claims, seemingly with accuracy, that she is the first African woman teacher, teaching artists in the Republic. So again, that you start to see these questions, and then became my tool of navigating this position. Whilst I'm really interested in this really vital, really bold artist in the 1960s, a history that for me was really absent, and I'd gone through an undergraduate program and finished I never really found myself. And to find out that there's this woman in the 1960s who was asserting this kind of position was really exciting. The Oxford Online Dictionary on Artists and Arts asked me to write a biography on Gladys. And it was interesting to respond back post having done the master's dissertation, which was focusing on Gladys, that I found it really interesting the debates that were going between myself and the editor, where she wanted me to write, rewrite biographies of her that are already existing online. And I said, well, there are certain things that become questionable, and what happens when you start writing a biography that isn't about certain accuracy, but really sets in doubt in ways that are, that's what we sit with today. So I was interested in positioning and delivering accounts that one can verify. This idea of self-taught has been quite a contentious thing as well. But by putting forward moments in which Gladys is actually acquiring knowledge for herself was really important. But also was important was the fact that her date of birth had been inconsistently documented. And it's important to put forward all of those inconsistencies as a way of saying, we'll never really know for sure, because that remains a question in the archive. And what happens when you put that in the artist's biography? Because it's always, it's so subjective to write the absolutes, this is what it is, but we always shy away from putting forward things that are doubtful. Going back to the question of the archive, I was really relying a lot on the publication Refiguring the Archive, because it starts to cement a moment that speaks back to a South African context. And one of the points that they talk about is the idea that the archive is porous, the idea that the archive is forever changing. You can never really say for sure that the information that you find there is absolute. And these were questions that came up over and over again. One of the things that was really interesting is how much there was on Gladys. This was for me constantly a surprise. The amount of exhibitions she had produced, the amount of exhibitions that she had followed on her passing, continued to cement her work. And again, it was interesting to see with her biography the constant inconsistencies with her date of birth. They were really interesting. You may not be able to see this, but this is kind of to give you an idea of the amount of public position she held, the amount of press she was able to accumulate during her time. And an example, this photograph was actually given to me by one of the people that I came across. I went to the library one day, trying to find information, and I bumped into a woman who said, actually I was at the exhibition opening when the first exhibition happened. This is me trying to find information. And out of that relationship, I then connected to a series of people who were part of the Liberal Party in 1961, which is where her first exhibition took place. So from there, it suddenly opened up a whole world for me in getting information. Some of it, obviously, without any proper referencing, but at the same time, it just allowed me to gain an idea of what exactly happened. So taking that exhibition and taking it in a moment that happens in 1961 and bringing it to Jeff was quite challenging, because here you are superimposing again in another kind of space that is itself quite a contentious space. So I was quite aware and very wary of bringing this exhibition and trying to work within a space that in itself was quite problematic. This is just to give you an example of the exhibition. The layout of the exhibition, I'm sure many of you are familiar with the Johannesburg Art Gallery. This was the top floor. So you navigated the exhibition from the left to the right. Oops, sorry. Okay. So in the first room, you had text, as we normally do. Again, the text was there. There's a series of things that I was very conscious to try out, this idea of text and image, and how the relationship of text. Again, if you're working in the context of a museum, you're constantly aware that there are different kinds of audiences and how you cater to both. Some audiences will hold on to text, and some audiences really don't need text to aid their viewing experience. So there was a lot of text deliberately to allow that kind of conversation to happen. So you had a framing of the exhibition, which kind of gave you an idea of how I was constructed the exhibition. The first room, we walked into a room of Valerie Desmond's work. Valerie Desmond's work, as I said in the beginning, I was interested in finding out this idea of the first. And after doing much research, I then discovered that Valerie Desmond came before and appeared before Jackson died in 1943. And this room, really, I wanted to reflect back on the institution's positioning of artists. So I did research museums around the country to find out if they had any work by Valerie Desmond. And of course, it was only the Johannesburg Art Gallery and the National Gallery Cape Town that had her work. And this room was deliberately to point out this idea that even when she was included again in 1997, to point out that, you know, there are these artists that have been omitted in history, her work has never really been followed up, with only four works in South Africa and quite an important artist that still remains absent. So this room, all you saw was these four works, and the text accompanying that was a series of questions to say, if we are to understand that Gladys, the land who appears in 61, and then we have Valerie Desmond, what does that give us an understanding of how historically black artists have been written into history? There's also a quote, the letter that she wrote to Elsa Myers, who curated the exhibition in 1997, saying, you know, she left in the early 40s because she was trying to escape the racial segregation, and she's never really gone back. But she's well known in London, and yes, South Africa still remains not really aware of her work. Then from that room, we moved into the restage room. This was really the main space for this exhibition. And in this room, it was really a series of questions. It was the idea of taking an archive file and opening it up and trying to revisualize the archive as it stands today. So again, I was really deliberate in not offering conclusive and absolute ways of looking at the archive. This is what we have, it's clean. But rather to kind of say there are a lot of missing information. There's this much information we've got. So there were a series of visual strategies that I implemented in this room that were about asking those questions. For one, the idea that there was a retrospective on her work in 2002, and part of this book records in Budandu as one that was promoted by women back in the 1960s. And to come across a random Vine, who was the chairperson of the Liberal Party then, who said he met Budandu and offered this opportunity to her, suddenly, again, set up a whole lot of questions around this idea of who promoted artists and who gives this idea of being discovered and this idea of being promoted by certain types of people. And in this exhibition space, I was interested in a certain voice, but in the most subtle way. So I recorded a conversation with him trying to remember meeting Gladys and talking about how the first exhibition emerged. I was going to play the voice recording for a moment of time. that with these headphones, the idea would have been you then listen to him trying to remember the exhibition, him saying, well, I remember meeting with her, she bought her portfolio, and I don't remember how we actually eventually had the exhibition, but it happened in this space. And there were a series of those conversations that happened with other people that I had now been in conversation with, but it was really interesting that he, as a male, becomes this person that opened this door for her. Some of the other strategies was around the idea that since the exhibition in 2002, and many of you will be aware of this, the Minnesotan artist has a retrospective, there's a boom, the works reappears, there's a lot of sales in auction houses, and the exhibition in 2002 sort of did that with Gladys's work. So when I tried to follow back and try to find some of his works, even though Elsa Miles had done a really well-documented way she had gotten all the works for that exhibition, I hardly found some of them. So it was important for me to have some sort of representation of those works in this space, even if it meant having references of them and not the actual work. Again, here, the idea is that we're dealing with the archive. So we had a series of spaces where the work was presented in the form of a book and not the actual work. And sometimes the work was projected on the wall. This was a couple that stays in Scotland who also were part of the work, were at the opening, but also spent a number of long conversations with them around the experience of the exhibition, what had happened. They had four works. But due to funding limitations and also they not being very comfortable selling their work, we resorted to having the works photographs and then projected in the space. Again, this was about reinforcing the idea that the archive is porous and the art, some of these works are no longer accessible. So you had works projected on the wall. I'll go back to the document on the table, which was really the moment in which the exhibition started to happen for me. So I was also interested in this idea of self-definition and voice. People like Christina Kunda were quite important for me in understanding some of the problems in the way that history cements certain ways of thinking, this idea of being spoken for, this idea of finding ways of reinserting the voice. I was very much aware of my cultural voice over the language voice, and I was interested in overcoming those kinds of limitations. And one of the ways, this document here, which was then the catalogue, was actually the first document that I found in realizing this exhibition. That's all I had, the list of works and evergreen documents. And this was through granddaughter of Mavis Copeland, who was a collector based in Cape Town. And I was excited, got the document now, I didn't know how many works were in the exhibition. But with the challenge of just what was called a catalogue then, you had only the list of works, no mediums, no sizes, how do I then go back and find these artworks that were in this show? So I knew there were 31 works. I knew the date of when the exhibition happened, and I knew where it actually happened, but that's all I had. And so, again, these moments where the works are on the wall, I had taken all this list of works and I had vinyled them across the room. So you had a record of how many works were in that space. And then I had the joy of trying to match these names to works that I found. Some works had been renamed. And some works I could, one or two, still had the original names. In some instances there were question marks, and I will get to that. But at the same time, I was interested in this idea of her voice being inserted. So some of the conversations I had, you know, everybody remembered that there was a table in the room. We removed all the chairs, because this was a room. We removed all the chairs, but the table remained. And we put up all the works on the wall. So I was trying to recapture that essence. So I got this table. Apparently belonged and was made for an exhibition for William Kentridge. But I had, it was a beautiful table that I could actually use to give that sense of the table in the room. And I'd taken a moment in which she speaks for herself and tried to give her a voice in this space. Again, playing around with the conceptual idea of the table as a space for conversation. So I took vinyl lettering of where she speaks about her own work and had that put on the table. And here she's asked, she'll try to print realistically, and she replies, you know, but to me they are realistic. And that for me was quite profound, is that in the sense that she's speaking about her own creations. She's articulating her own work and her own understanding of why she's producing work. So these were, again, the catalog sits next to that as a way of locating that particular time. Some moments in the exhibition, there were really question marks. So you had three works. One of the works actually belongs to Nelson Mandela Metropolitan Museum. The three works were of the same title and were closely fitting to this title in the catalogue. And I wasn't going to make that choice because, again, it is about presenting the moments of doubt. And so you had these three, they were kind of clustered together as a way, again, to push forward these moments of doubt and to work with these moments of doubt as a way of asking a series of questions. Extending to that, I then got other documents that were useful in a sense that the 1962 exhibition was a way to counter back and see works that I came across that possibly, even if I was trying to find works that she had produced in 1961, they would have possibly been exhibited the following year. So the 1962 catalogue was for me a measure to make sure that I wasn't taking work that would have been exhibited in 1962 and put them in the 1961 exhibition. So you would have moved away from the restage into the last two rooms. The last two rooms were at my framing of it was the last collection. While I was doing research, I came across the collector was based in Cape Town, who, fortunately, I suppose, the son of Gladys Mulatto was working for him. And he, before dying, and he was being kicked out of his home where he lived with his mother, had these artworks and didn't really know what to do with them. So he took them to who then was his employer and said, I don't know what to do with this, can you look after it? And so this guy thought, oh well, these are really, I don't know who this artist is, they're probably not really that valuable. Check them, put them in storage. And in 2006, when he was still selling his business, he suddenly found out that he had this collection. And he remembers seeing something about the exhibition of hers 4 years or 2 years earlier. So he went to see George Dolby at the National Museum to speak to him about these works. What do I do with them? Do I resell them? And was very, you know, with a stern finger pointing at him. George Dolby told him that how bad he had been because the works had been very damaged and there was no value for them, you know. And he tried to restore some of them very badly and had these works. So, and I thought, again, it's so easy to say with museums, you work with particular standards, there's certain things that you can and cannot display. So for me, it was really interesting to work with this collection. Most of which you could not display, they were really, really fragile objects. But it was interesting, again, working with the notion of the archive, that that becomes registered again. Here's this collection that is no longer valuable in a particular way, but becomes valuable when you think about it as a record of history. So this room was showing this collection. It was also showing some of the ephemera objects that I found that were also sent to me. Again, you start to see Gladys' voice being inserted, her being very active about promoting herself and writing to many of us open and saying, I've got an exhibition opening, please come. And this is again seeing how she was very instrumental in asserting her own voice, in asserting her own career as an artist. You know, some of the moments where you see, oh my God, it only cost 69 rand to get a painting by Vandy, because now, you know, you pay half a million to get one. So these two rooms showcase these objects. Some of them, just to give you a sense of the extent of the damage on them, I used the glass cabinets to some that we couldn't actually put up on the wall. Just examples of some of the extent of the damage. And we moved on from that room into the 1980s. And again, going back to where I started, I was interested in this idea. So if we start with Gladys, what happens after that? And again, implicating the institution. Who has this institution collected after Gladys? Who exists in the collections today? So just about writing and then going and running and looking at who were the artists out there. But working at JAM for me was really interesting in how the writing of history starts there. These are the institutions that have collated and collected these archives. So this exhibition showcased women artists, black women artists that in the collection, and a combination, and it also just showed the kind of diversity of diverse works that in the 1980s were being collected, the kind of artists that were entering into this institution. And that would have been the end of the exhibition. And of course, the opening happened. I'll show you these pictures. And yeah, we had the Nkomotse again. These were like my moments where I was kind of like going beyond the archive and into the archive. One of the things that was quite commonly said with Gladys Nkomotse's opening is that she brewed Solomon beer and brought it to the opening. This was quite a thing with the openings. So it was just one of those gestures. That was quite interesting in the opening. And I'll end there. We'll start tomorrow.
Yeah, what is it?
It's a museum. people that have kind of done projects that I sort of resonate with. And Fred Wilson is an artist and also has experience working in a museum. And he was invited to respond to their collection. And his response was that project, Mining Museum, which is about working, he actually worked with their collection, but started to shift the way the collection would have been displayed by asking those questions in through different displays. Since I showed you some of the displays. So I was showing that project as a way to kind of show that these are thoughts that I sort of found myself into the spaces in which I think this is where what I'm concerned with also has been integrated. Because I'm also very wary that, you know, the course that I've just introduced, which is exhibition histories, that, you know, curatorial practices don't happen in a vacuum. There's a history of thoughts and questions that have been asked in the past. It's important to, as a curator, to be aware of those projects and understanding how those questions have been asked before. So, you know, they become your reference point in thinking about, also thinking about solutions and strategies in dealing with some of these questions that, you know, going back to exhibition histories. So that was the reason I showed that exhibition. In terms of writing, this is a lifetime project. You know, I think both writing formal texts and publications, this is not my task alone. I kind of see writing my projects of South Africa as something that needs to bring to bear some of these critical, all this crisis really that needs to be addressed. And also, I think, my own practice as a curator, I see that space of writing being expanded into curating practices. That as we're writing or text that goes into a publication, the writing already happens in the expression in that moment. My sort of constant reference is the fact that art becomes known through exhibition. The first writing about an artwork's artist's visibility happens in a moment of showing. So if that form of writing is done right, then what follows after that is cemented from an event in the moment. So that's, yeah, so it's an ongoing project.
Thank you.
Nonto, you know, I have a personal interest in by books resurrecting Audre Lorde's idea of biomythography,
mm-hmm.
And this idea that we're not in search of truths, but in truth, but in search of multiple truths,
yeah.
And creating textured narratives. I must say, it's amazing to see a curator harness that in this exhibition and give a visualization to it. I haven't seen anything like that, so. I was really sorry to miss the exhibition, but just hearing you speak about it and seeing it, for me, it's a new benchmark in South African curating. But I do wonder as well, because as people of color, we're constantly having to go back and resurrect and resurrect and resurrect as things get buried. So in terms of longer term kind of documentation and having access to this, you know, did JAG make funds available for a catalogue, or is there an online platform? I'm not aware of Desmo's work, so for me this is also a revelation as well. You know, it's a process of learning every day living in South Africa and unearthing stuff. So what kind of long-term strategies has there been for keeping this alive so that in another 20 years we don't have to come and resurrect it again?
Which is very possible. So, and a side story, before starting to work at JAG, I had already registered doing my master's, and I applied to JAG to have the exhibition, and then the post opened up to work there, and I thought, okay, if I'm working there, then I'll be able to use the institutional muscle to realize this exhibition. And, well, to my surprise, the challenge of actually putting such an exhibition together was extremely hard. It was out of my own personal funding. And so the catalog didn't happen. But, and I'm quite wary of saying this, there have been a number of interest from institutions who are not South African in taking this project forward. And I'm very cautious because it's so easy for them to be that other project that exists elsewhere in South Africa. I've been interested in exploring an online platform, but for now really it is about me just talking to this content and it doesn't really exist anywhere else. There's ephemera of it online.
I'm just, I don't know whether you saw Kimbanga's exhibition.
I haven't yet. Okay. I meant to.
No, because I was going to ask you a question based on some of the works that he's done himself, based like how unearthing basically some of Gladys's work that hasn't been seen basically as part of an archive. But also like that's sort of a, how do you talk about when that's sort of an archive as part of a, as part of an acquisition, basically. Then who owns that archive, basically?
Well, again, the idea of archive is expanded. It's quite, you know, you cannot talk about the archive, which is why I'm referring to the archives, again, going back to the project we created with archive, in the emphasis of the archive theme, of course, archive is existing in many, many different forms and is housed in different ways. We engage with it, we take part of it, we use it, and we reconfigure it in many different ways. And you know, I had a long conversation with Iman about his project before, while he was still making it. And he said to me, yeah, I went to the exhibition to send me your thesis. And I sent it to him, and he had read it, and we sat down and we spoke about, you know, my process of engaging with Gladys. And I think he took those things into account just from conversations and hearing some of the presentations. And it's exciting to see, again, how the archive becomes expanded. And he's doing that very thing. He's taken part of the archive, reconfigured it, and he's finding himself in it. He's finding himself in this history and trying to re-engage why he's actually making art. So I haven't seen the work, but I've seen images of the installation. And I think it's exciting to see that kind of work. It is a very project to why you started a project, to see it grow and manifest in different ways, such as what it is now.
I have a question for you. You initiate the first room as you entered into the exhibition and you had a big wall of text. And then you talked about how some people like to have a lot of text in exhibitions and some people don't like reading. And some schools of thought that you mustn't have any text on that exhibition. I know when Hitchlam had his exhibition, which involved in Pause, it was like, so its title of the exhibition, you wanted no text, no speech, no handout, nothing, that's what you prefer. But you made a comment that, you made a comment that there was a lot of text as a way of creating a dialogue. And I think I understood to mean the dialogue between people who like lots of text or don't like lots of text and people who engage with different
things. Well, yeah, the dialogue was really the kind of aesthetics that images provide and text provides, and that relationship between those two kinds of strategies. The text was really not about giving people answers, it was a series of questions. So it was again disrupting this idea that you went and once you read the text you knew exactly what was happening, but rather how the text, and hence I also mentioned in that first room with Valerie Desmond, that it had a series of questions. So it was about countering and using the aesthetics of text, what you have on the wall, it looks beautiful, it's an image in itself. And how when you do, even those who gravitate towards have been confronted by questions rather than an answer, because usually people go towards reading a text, a blurb, and finding answers. This is what the curator is saying about this. But when you start disrupting them, putting questions rather than the conclusions, then you start, you know, asking people to think more about why they're actually looking at certain things. So there was the play between the conversations and ours, talking to the text and the image, that in that space it was about how the text is asking questions at the images and the describes.
Okay, I think this, I'm just kind of referring to another text, which is about essentially, since the guy wrote this type of work. I see that as different, just sort of your own process of trying to articulate and answer some of the questions that came out of your process and knowledge. But I guess in trying to realize the moon, which would perhaps be like a coffee, you know, some output for this particular process. What other ways can do you think through bilateral engagements that you could, this work could also go to come to this province, or perhaps, you know, go out from you? I mean, are there particular imaginations around this at this stage?
I've never started the project as a traveling project, but I imagine the methodology of doing the project is a traveling process, is what I understand. And for me, I think that's a really key thing. Trying to restage this issue, I'm not sure what it would do differently, except just offer to a different audience. But I think what is really key for me, and perhaps maybe this is where I want to go back to showing this question, where we want to move forward is to kind of think about what kind of methodology does this start to offer us, methodologies that could be thought through the practice of curating. How do we think about revision work and work that is about estimating the archive, and offer one kind of methodology that could also start to think about other kinds of methodologies around curating. So, I mean, I've had an invitation that came to help, so, you know, to go back and think about projects. And to me, it's never been about, okay, I want to restage the same exhibition. Think about how would I kind of do another exhibition that goes back to those methodologies and maybe even the same content. But it is about asking questions, it is about estimating the archive.
Yeah, but my question was, I think it was really just in terms of broader audience. To go on.
Yeah. The question of audience is always kind of difficult. But I think, again, if you wanted to think about it as a method, in that once the method is quite, you know, it's very centered, broadening it to other audiences, it means that their connection, even if they want to discover the other projects, they understand the kind of scholarship you're working, the kind of thing. So broadening the audience starts to think about how does method allow for the broadening of those audiences? Or does one allow for projects to emerge and be implemented in other places? That starts to speak back to a practice, kind of formula and methodology.
Yeah, on behalf of all of us, thank you so much for a very stimulating talk and exposing to this audience an incredibly powerful exhibition. So thank you so much for your time.